Coming up on today's show, Tesla's Q1 delivery estimates send share prices soaring, Daimler drops hydrogen fuel cells, Tesla tries to explain the difference between Model S and Model 3, and we ask if Ferrari is developing an electric Formula E car. These stories and more coming next on 10. Like all our content, today's show is funded by the in-stream ads on today's video and by the kind donations of viewers like you. Follow the link at the end of today's video to make a monthly donation to our Patreon crowdfunding campaign to help keep us independent and impartial. And if you're already donating, thanks for your continued support. It's Friday, April 7th, 2017. I'm Nikki Gordon Bloomfield, and this is T.E.N, a show that's happy to bring you the news in the world of cleaner, greener, safer, and smarter transportation, be it land, air, or sea. And today's show is actually powered by an electric car, too, because we've had a power cut and the show is being edited on power supplied by our Nissan Leaf. And having just ended the first quarter, it's that time again when we delve into Tesla's quarterly delivery estimate report, which plopped into my inbox sometime on Sunday morning last week. The report provides a rough idea of how many cars Tesla made and shipped around the world during the first quarter of this year to an accuracy of around 0.5%, give or take, and comes ahead of the release of official figures, which Tesla will release in about a month's time as part of its quarterly earnings report. Now, this time round, it shows Tesla making just over 25,400 cars during the first quarter and delivering around 25,000, a dramatic improvement on last year, thanks to a 54-46% split between Model S and Model X. And it shows that Tesla's market share is just getting bigger and bigger. It's no surprise then that, despite Tesla's financial losses in recent years, the shares for Tesla have rocketed under this estimate, catapulting the shares above $300 and giving Tesla a market cap above that of Ford. That said, however, I should note that while Tesla's market cap is currently higher than Ford's, the latter is still a much bigger car company, producing more vehicles in a week than Tesla did in a quarter. That fact, however, doesn't mean that mainstream automakers aren't afraid of Tesla. In fact, Tesla's doing so well in the plug-in marketplace that I've covered several stories of late involving automakers teaming up or pushing forward their electric vehicle programs in order to play catch-up. And this week is no exception, with Volkswagen-owned brands Porsche and Audi making an official announcement that they would work together on both future electric vehicle and autonomous car projects in an attempt to bring them to market more quickly. Audi and Porsche, both of which suffered as a consequence of the Dieselgate debacle, have traditionally kept their electric and autonomous vehicle programs separate from one another, despite being part of the same automotive family. But with both brands eager to tackle Tesla with full-size electric sedans and SUVs, an agreement has been struck that will tie both Audi and Porsche electric vehicles together until 2025. And after that point, both brands should have enough plug-in vehicles in development to go back to their current arrangement. Although I should note here, even then, chassis sharing and power plant sharing are just as likely to continue, as they have done for decades already. From two brands focusing on beating Tesla to another next, in the form of Daimler, which announced at the tail end of last week that despite pushing forward with its plans to produce the GLC F-cell plug-in fuel cell crossover, for fleet customers only, it would be shifting its company focus towards battery electric rather than hydrogen fuel cell vehicles. The reasons given? Well, hydrogen infrastructure just isn't ready for prime time, and the costs of hydrogen fuel cell vehicle production remain prohibitively high. Electric vehicles, on the other hand, are now capable of impressive range thanks to improved battery technology, are cheaper to produce thanks to falling battery costs, and are super easy to refuel. Hydrogen, meanwhile, well, that's off the table until the price of hydrogen fuel falls and fuel cell stacks are cheaper to make. I'm going to let you decide how long, if ever, that will take. We're off to Menlo Park, California next, where startup automaker Lucid is working on raising $700 million in its latest funding round in order to build a $700 million production facility in Casa Grande, Arizona. According to Lucid CTO and former Tesla Model S designer Peter Rawlinson, Lucid's manufacturing facility will be built in three phases, with the first expected to cost around $240 million. When complete, that section of the factory aims to begin construction of its luxury Lucid Air electric sedan sometime by 2019, ramping up to production of between 8 and 10,000 vehicles per year. If all three stages, the final stage expected to be completed by 2022, are completed, the total investment will hit $700 million, but it's clear at the moment that Lucid is being as cautious as possible, presumably so that it avoids some of the pitfalls of other would-be Teslas, like Faraday Future, for example. It's no secret that Tesla, while it's pushing full steam ahead with its upcoming Model 3 electric sedan, isn't being all that aggressive in marketing the car. In fact, as Tesla CEO Elon Musk has noted several times now, Tesla is actively engaging in anti-selling Model 3, encouraging customers to opt for Model S or even Model X rather than Model 3 when possible. Well, on Thursday, things took another interesting turn when Tesla actually posted a blog post on its site reminding customers that Model S and Model 3 are very different cars. Reiterating that Model 3 won't be a better car than Model S, the post states that Model S will still be Tesla's premium, market-leading sedan, complete with more power, more room, and more technology than Model 3. Model 3, meanwhile, it reiterated, will be simpler, smaller, and come with fewer options than Model S. And while those of us in the automotive world already know that, it's clear that Tesla might be worrying a little that mainstream buyers, and perhaps the mainstream press, don't know that. Either way, it makes sense to be upfront as possible about it, right? Since it was founded several years ago, Hyperloop One, one of the two US-based firms seeking to commercialize the world of Hyperloop travel, has unveiled details of the top 11 routes in the US that Hyperloop could revolutionize. Sourced by teams competing in the Hyperloop One Global Challenge, the 11 routes, which join up major US cities, would have the power to dramatically slash travel times between both nearby cities and neighboring regions, slashing the time it takes to get from Portland to Seattle, for example, to just 17.2 minutes, making the LA to San Diego sprint in 12 and a half minutes, and traversing the 640-mile sprint between Dallas and Austin, Texas, in just under 20 minutes. Of course, this is all still hypothetical, but with Hyperloop One readying itself to work with the UAE on what is expected to be the world's first commercial Hyperloop, once all of those technical challenges have been ironed out, that is, we're going to just have to see if Hyperloop can deliver, or if it's just vaporware and fantasy. Watch this space. Here's one for you. Which companies are currently leading in the world of autonomous vehicles? Any ideas? No, it's not Tesla. At least, that's according to a study produced this week by Navigant Research, which puts Ford, General Motors, and the Renault-Nissan Alliance at the top of the autonomous vehicle charts, and Tesla all the way down in 12th place. How? Why? Well, while the study does give Tesla the lead when it comes to technology currently available in the marketplace, it also examined autonomous vehicle technology being developed by each of the major automakers and companies like Waymo and Uber, as well as each company's strategy to bring that technology to market. And while Tesla's current strategy has placed it in the lead of cars you can buy today, the hint is that this study expects other automakers to overtake Tesla in the next few years, as each bring their own brand of autonomous vehicle capabilities to market. I guess we'll have to wait and find out if the study's authors are right or not. From one study to another now, but this one that predicts the average price paid for the Tesla Model 3 sedan will be a little higher than the $42,000 price tag Elon Musk had predicted, and quite a lot higher than the headline-grabbing $35,000 price tag. At least, that's according to data analyst Ben Sullins, who has been tracking the data from nearly 8,000 Model 3 reservation holders at model3tracker.info, a site devoted to tracking the reservation details and expected options that reservation holders will say they'll take if offered them. Sullins says the data suggests most reservation holders are expecting to pay between $45,000 and $55,000 for their car, demonstrating that while Tesla's Model 3 is being seen by many as a mass market affordable car, many early customers will be paying far more for cars that could be considered generally affordable. I guess the real time test is to see if the price remains high after all those pre-reservations have been filled. Do you agree? Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Staying on the subject of sales, I've got a little news here for you regarding US sales figures of plug-in cars during the month of March. And interestingly, it shows some fun trends that were not expected. For example, the Nissan Leaf, now getting pretty long in the tooth after 7 years of sales, outsold the brand new long-distance Chevrolet Bolt EV for a second month in a row, selling 1,478 cars to the Bolt's 978. But to be fair, some of that is believed to be thanks to some pretty big discounts being offered by Nissan in order to clear out Leaf inventory ahead of the expected September launch of the next-gen Leaf. Also interesting is the number of plug-in hybrids sold last month, which completely eclipsed the number of pure electric vehicles sold, thanks to good months of both the Ford Energy plug-in hybrid, Prius Prime plug-in hybrid, and Chevrolet Volt extended range EV, which many consider a plug-in hybrid. At the start of today's show, I hinted that we would be covering more than just cars in today's show, and this next story is proof of that, with news of a brand new speed record set by an all-electric Stunt airplane made by Siemens. The Siemens Extra 33LE plane, powered by a super powerful lightweight electric motor, hit a record-breaking 340 kilometers per hour, that's 212 miles per hour, back at the end of March, putting it into the record books. And if that wasn't enough, it also became the first all-electric plane to tow a glider into the air, towing a Type LS8 Neo glider to a height of 600 meters in just 76 seconds. And since not all gliding clubs can make use of winch lifts, this is very exciting news indeed, since gliding itself is a very environmentally friendly thing. It's just the getting up there that isn't always so green. Well done, guys. On to trucks next. We're off to Peloton, a startup company backed by hardware giant Intel, which has just begun a new round of funding to try and bring its automated truck convoy technology to market by the end of this year. The goal of the technology is pretty simple, allowing truck drivers to virtually connect their trucks to one another on long-haul routes in order to become massively long truck trains, following one another far more closely than would be possible with a human driver, with the frontmost truck leading the others in mother duck and chick style. The benefits? Reduced drag and improved fuel efficiency, plus obviously less risk of driver fatigue or injury. While the firm has been working with regulators, truck operators, vehicle manufacturers, and technology providers to perfect its system, Peloton is still confident that it will have its technology in the marketplace and saving trucking firms billions in fuel costs long before fully autonomous trucks hit the market. This next story might seem a little weird, but stick with me because I think it's kind of cool. Meet TankTwo, a new battery system for electric cars, which, instead of using either a traditional solid battery pack or liquid electrolyte, is made up of lots of tiny battery balls, which you literally pour into a battery tank. Once poured in, the batteries, which have contacts on all sides, can intelligently orient themselves, figuring out the best way of connecting themselves to each other, and then send the power to your vehicle's drivetrain. I'm doing a terrible job of explaining it, but claims the Finnish-American company behind it, it could revolutionize the way we think about electric vehicle battery packs and, since the modules are infinitely configurable, could lead to some pretty interesting electric vehicle capabilities. Oh, and if your battery becomes low, you just swap it out at a swap station, pouring out the old batteries and pouring the new ones in. Yeah, I'm not convinced 100%, but this one was just too fun sounding not to include in today's show. And finally, when it comes to a pathological distrust and hatred of electric cars, there are few as vocal as FCA boss Sergio Marchionne, who happens to be the guy in charge of Ferrari. And in both positions over the years, we've heard Sergio spout frustration over compliance car regs to shooting down in flames anyone who suggested ever making an electric Ferrari, calling the idea obscene. Well, this week, Marchionne showed signs that he might be rethinking that position, telling Auto, Fiat's magazine, that when it comes to Fiat's Formula E race series, we need to be involved, adding that electrification via hybridization is going to be part of our future. Sure, it's not out and out support for electric vehicles, but hey, it's proof that everyone can change their opinion, right? And on that note, I'm off. As always, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Visit transportevolve.com for more cleaner, greener, safer, and smarter transportation news, or join in the conversation on Twitter at TransportEvolved. And if you liked what you saw today and you want to help us make more shows like this, please consider making a donation to the Patreon crowdfunding campaign for Transport Evolved, a link for which is in the description below and a clickable one at the end of today's video. Thanks again for joining me. I'll see you next week. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. That was 10. Have a fantastic weekend. And until next time, keep evolving.